I've always believed that there is an art to telling a story that appeals to teens. Over the years, they've evolved from early examples such as James Dean's trio of Rebel Without a Cause, Giant, and East of Eden, to American Graffiti, a lot of early slasher horror movies like Halloween or A Nightmare on Elm Street. Also, who can forget the charm of 1980s hits like The Breakfast Club, or combinations with other genres like Back to the Future or Red Dawn? Thanks, Brian. Or offering a new perspective on the genre in something like 2004's hit comedy Mean Girls or the meta-horror hit Scream. Nowadays, a teen movie can relate to recent hits like The Fault in Our Stars, Boyhood, or Love, Simon. And of course, we can't forget teen adventures like Harry Potter or Spider-Man. I was inspired to make this video due to another video essayist, the Nerdwriter, who highlighted Battle Royale as being the best teen movie, and I wanted to use that format as an example to show what we can learn from my all-time favorite teen movie, and that's Richard Kelly's 2001 cult classic, Donnie Darko. So what exactly makes a teen protagonist appealing? Well, I think a lot of them fail when writers just go for a typical naive stereotype without much personality.
Has anyone ever told you that you're sexy?
I like your boobs.
Hey!
And what makes a great teen movie is when writers are smart enough to subvert this, and treat teenagers like they can be as complex and interesting as any other character. In the case of Donnie Darko, it tells the story of a troubled teenager who is plagued with visions of a person wearing a large bunny suit warning him about the end of the world, essentially putting the fate of the universe into our protagonist's hands. Richard Kelly's opening sequence establishes who Donnie is immediately by drawing attention to the relatively normal people living in his suburb. Our eyes linger at him biking back to the house in his pajamas, since in our eyes, he stands out. But the pajamas also indicate elements of an everyman persona, thus creating juxtaposition between the everyman and an outsider. The camera later draws attention to Donnie's mother reading a copy of Stephen King's It, a story about a group of children growing into adulthood when a monster plagues their town, perhaps a foreshadowing of what's to come and highlighting the kind of complex fiction that Richard Kelly is a fan of, which is continued by several plot points in the movie relating to Graham Greene's short story The Destructors and Richard Adams' Watership Down. The movie isn't concerned with making Donnie likable. He has far more in common with protagonists like Catcher in the Rye's Holden Caulfield than the standard teen protagonist, with several scenes showing him to lack empathy towards his family and everyone around him. This taps into childhood memories of arguments at the dinner table or slamming the door in your parents' face when you just want to be left alone. This is even played against his younger sister Samantha, who presents questions around the adult concepts Donnie and his older sister argue about at the dinner table, like sex and marriage, creating a fine line between innocent curiosity and teenage angsty nihilism. If you look now, edgy teen characters are rather popular. Why else in the reboot of Riverdale, which has Archie Andrews as its main character, is the new, edgier take on Jughead Jones more popular with fans? Similarly, play this against Cody Martin, another Cole Sprouse role where he was constantly humiliated and upstaged by his admittedly edgier older sibling Zach. And let's be honest, we laughed.
Who dares defile my throne?
Don't melt my face!
You didn't do stuff to the body, did you? Like, after?
It's called necrophilia, Reggie. Can you spell it?
When people say they find edginess off-putting, it confuses me. because the best character moments in teen movies come from what teenagers do in every day of their lives. Challenging authority, believing you know better than adults, confusion on how the world around you doesn't make sense, it's all themes we related to in our teenage lives when we felt we had no one to talk to, so these characters give us comfort, relatability, and in Donnie Darko's case, a little bit of wish fulfillment, which I'll get onto now.
God damn right I...
Whether we see it or not, as teenagers we like to think that we're smarter than adults, and maybe to a higher extent everyone around us. Our experiences and what we seek to learn and how we interpret that knowledge form our views and determine the actions we take in the world. And Donnie Darko is no exception. At the inciting incident of the story, Donnie is saved from being crushed to death by a falling jet engine, a seemingly random event. His guardian angel, so to speak, appears as a daytime hallucination in a man dressed in a giant demonic-looking bunny rabbit suit named Frank. Taking something pure like a rabbit and shaping it into this nightmarish vision could possibly be an implication on how teenagers like Donnie will take something innocent and warp it into something unsettling or evil, in an attempt to be cooler, so to say. Richard Kelly films a lot of the scenes involving Frank with an eerie, hypnotic atmosphere. An element that a lot of film fans say keeps drawing them back to Donnie Darko is the weary nature of the camera that could speak to how a confused, frustrated teenager might view the world, something that appears so hazy that they can't control it. After his brush with death, Donnie is then given the gift of knowledge by Frank, as on his arm it shows numbers that act as a ticking clock to when the world will end, thus giving the movie a quick pacing despite the slow burn atmosphere. This knowledge feeds into Donnie's mindset that he has some sort of destiny, like he's a messiah figure who has been chosen by a higher power to save the world. And this is true of a lot of teenagers like Donnie. We have to ask ourselves if, given this information, this power, what would we do? Would we use it to create or to destroy?
Well, they say it right when they flood the house and they tear it to shreds that, like, destruction is a form of creation, so the fact that they burn the money is ironic.
Donnie then uses this information as a backdrop for his later acts of teenage rebellion, such as flooding the school, acting as both an homage to the story he was taught in English class, Graham Greene's The Destructors, in which a group of kids burn money that they had intended to steal. It's notable that Donnie interprets this as being ironic, since his act of flooding the school could be seen as the same. The one place that feeds him knowledge that he can use, he essentially destroys so it can be reborn. It's ironic that Donnie would want to destroy the place where he feels like he can learn, but it also ties into the curiosity he has about his destiny with Frank, suggesting he wishes to spend more time on that. The question this asks is what teenagers will do with the knowledge they are given. While some students, especially in Donnie's English class, may view the story as surface level, Donnie sees beyond the big picture, and being gifted with what he views as destiny, takes it upon himself to follow it and alter the natural path. A lot of teenage life can be rather lonely, especially if you're introverted or don't do well in social situations. This is quite commonplace in a modern day high school environment, and thus, to cope with it, teenagers often put their trust in role models. A role model can be anybody, an actor, a writer, a teacher, a parent. Donnie Darko approaches the idea of role models from several different perspectives. On one hand, we have his family, which he's admittedly not very fond of, but then we have his teachers at school. Drew Barrymore's Miss Pomeroy and Noah Wyle's Dr. Monatoff both fit into this for Donnie. We see in his English class that Donnie gets along very well with Miss Pomeroy, who even exhibits some teenage characteristics herself, such as putting Gretchen on the spot when she first enters the class. She does a good job at allowing Donnie to have a space where he can express how he feels and even challenging his opinions to make himself more knowledgeable. Similarly, Dr. Monatoff takes an interest in Donnie after he comes to him with questions involving what will come of the world. Then pair this against two of the film's antagonists, Miss Farmer and Jim Cunningham. Two people who couldn't be further at odds with Donnie's ideologies. Miss Farmer is presented as a very shallow-minded, strict teacher who Donnie constantly gets frustrated with, and in turn, Miss Farmer preaches what she knows to her entire class, which is the recent videos of Jim Cunningham, a psychologist who oversimplifies large concepts such as fear into profitable books and a successful career. Even the name Miss Farmer could suggest that she is farming a cult-like mindset based on her own beliefs, expecting everyone to agree with her and closing off her brain from alternative ideas. Jim Cunningham is an interesting case because it seems from a glance that Donnie could simply be jealous of his success, but that changes when we see that Donnie really just hates the ideals he preaches. Where Cunningham may have started with good intentions, his ambition for fame and wealth obstruct him from achieving his true potential. And we can see here that Donnie doesn't really care what his school thinks of him, he just wants to make his opinion known, even mocking Cunningham to a degree where he uses a fake name to suggest that if Jim Cunningham is going to use a facade to trick the school, Donnie is going to use his tactics against him. A lot of Cunningham's philosophies outlaw things that are seen as regular teen behavior, such as premarital sex, drugs, and alcohol, something that teens regularly experience growing up, and of course that's just a natural part of life. What they do then on is up to them. Notice that the people Donnie respects don't talk down to him or tell him what the right answer is, but they simply give him the tools to understand it himself. A role model's job isn't to show someone the right answer, but more to guide them on the path so they can discover the right answer, as our experiences will dictate what we perceive as the right choice. When Donnie later retaliates by burning down Jim Cunningham's house, filmed in a way resembling lashing out, we then peel back the layers of his facade, and the film reveals to us that Cunningham possesses child pornography and he's later arrested for it. Miss Farmer's reaction to this is very similar to a shallow-minded disciple, constantly thinking it's a conspiracy theory when the evidence is overwhelming. Ironically, giving into fear. Even Donnie's actual role models display faults. When Miss Pomeroy is later fired, we then see her lash out in the parking lot, and when Dr. Monotov comes faced with a question he can't answer without losing his job, Donnie begins to see that role models and what teens may view as perfect figures are actually on the surface just people like him. In many cases, insecurity and identity go hand in hand. Donnie Darko shows this element through the introduction of Gretchen, played by Jenna Malone. Donnie immediately takes an interest in her, and they try to find common ground in their relationship, but it's clear that Gretchen is inherently more hopeful than Donnie, despite her dark past. Since, in their own ways, they're both outsiders, their different experiences allow them to grow together through the story. Donnie does have his insecurities as well, such as his compulsive need to be in the control of the conversation and correct everybody around him, presented in a scene where he and his friends talk about Smurfs.
First of all, Papa Smurf didn't create Smurfette, Gargamel did. And as for the whole gangbang scenario, it just couldn't happen. Smurfs are asexual.
Donnie later gets frustrated over his lack of control with his relationship with Gretchen, but the great part is that Gretchen's idealism forces Donnie to grow as a person and become more empathetic. Much like the people we date in our lives can force us to grow as people no matter what eventually comes of the relationship. When Donnie first tries to kiss her, Gretchen takes control of the scene as her tragic past makes her long for something pure in her life, and in a moment of vulnerability, she's the one who kisses him. This suggests that no matter what, we can't always get what we want as a teenager, but we can make do with what we have. It's not an ideal situation for either Donnie or Gretchen, but it feels very honest in its portrayal as opposed to a classic happy ending. Their ideologies are later tested in a discussion about the book Watership Down, where Donnie doesn't see the point in being upset over dead rabbits, hinting at both his frustration with Frank and how he's missed the point to a story that he may see as beyond him. Gretchen understands that Watership Down isn't as surface level as Donnie thinks, and it's the empathy that the author put into the story that makes it work. And from then on, Donnie begins to grow more empathetic and as a person, realizing his destiny may not be to save everyone, but perhaps to understand. This is probably the scariest element of Donnie Darko, and that's the indication that when you're a teenager, you can't wait to be an adult, but it does feel like the bomb clicking off, just waiting for your entire world to explode and be reborn into something vastly different. This is a very clear parallel to what happens to teenagers when they leave home, and Donnie Darko has already set this up with Frank's knowledge at the beginning and Donnie realizing what his destiny actually means in the film. Many of the characters, according to the philosophy of time travel, have been acting as living receivers, the manipulated living and the manipulated dead, and they have been put in place within the story to push Donnie towards his destiny, emulating an idea from teenagers that everyone around them is living in their world and not vice versa. Towards the end, Donnie has grown more empathetic, and in the final act, Gretchen is accidentally killed by a man wearing a bunny costume. This immediately flips Donnie's perception on Frank, not seeing him as a guardian angel but now as an omen of death. And in losing the balance in his life with the death of Gretchen, he retaliates by fulfilling the destiny of killing Frank. Later on, Donnie realizes that the world being saved is a lot bigger than him, and to correct the universe, he can't try to control everything and change it, and instead he lets things play out, taking us right back to the events of the inciting incident. Donnie leaves the world content with his decision, realizing his death was what saved the people around him, and whilst this could be viewed as a nihilistic message, I think it speaks to the feeling that sometimes teenagers feel the world would be better off without them. Donnie feels now that he has no purpose in life other than to die, and rather than challenge this perception, he sees that he doesn't want to live his life without balance. It's quite a bittersweet ending, as we see that Donnie's family is devastated by his death, but then Gretchen enters again in a similar fashion to how Donnie entered the movie, and we as the audience know what Gretchen doesn't. In the Tangent Universe, her relationship with Donnie led to her death, but through Donnie taking on his destiny, it gives us an idea that her world might end up being saved, and her idealism may go on to help her in the end. What's special about Donnie Darko isn't the laughs, or the cinematography, or the way the camera tells the story. What's special is no singular thing, but all these things. Like Donnie states in the movie, you can't have two conflicting emotions and then deny everything else. Teenagers need to experience as much as they can to prepare them for adulthood. It's somewhat of a tragedy that we never get to see the person Donnie may have become through his changed identity, but the ambiguity of the narrative and the honest portrayal of a teenager's life is what keeps us coming back for more. What makes Donnie Darko the best teen movie is that when you look at the world through the eyes of a teenager, you begin to see that there's no solid answer to your problems. Instead, it's just a mad, mad world.
What was his name?
Donnie. Donnie Darko.
Circles, it's a very, very mad.